relationship now, I don't know. God instituted marriage, and it is dumb for anybody to look at my face and tell me what God started doesn't work. That's just stupid. I just see for you to think like that. How can God start a project and you look into my face and tell me it doesn't work? That's rude. Just like looking at me and telling me the sun does not work. The concept of day and night does not work. What's that? Makes no sense. Makes you look like the foolish one. Because before you were born, before your dad met your mom, before your dad toasted your mom, this thing has been working. So it's not you. Because of some crap Kardashians that you've been watching, and you saw that it didn't work for them, you jump on social media and say crap like men are same, marriage does not work, marriage is not just worth it. What's this nonsense song they sing? If you don't want, you can divorce. I mean, how do they sing this? The song is just letting you know that it's not by force. If you put in the marriage, it doesn't work, you divorce. You know, those are indirect tutelage to train people to walk out of marriage, you know, which is actually sponsored by demons to frustrate people out of marriage and get their life scattered. Devil is a very smart guy. I tell you all the time, this guy has been around for a while. He has seen thousands of generations of people come and go. He knows what works and what doesn't work. So his aim is to pinpoint things that worked over time. Things that worked over generation. His main aim is to pick those things and make it, paint them as evil. Paint them as evil, number one, or make them not work in other coming generations, such that by ourselves, we are self-destroying our own future, our own destiny, we are destroying it by ourselves. Devil is not an omnipresence like God. If he's not in tow, he's in flow. He's not everywhere. Only God is the omnipresent God that you can find everywhere. Devil needs agents to be present everywhere. So what he does is to plant a seed in you and go, so that you will self-destroy yourself. It's not devil responsible for destroying everything. He's just one guy with plenty agents. So he's not everywhere trying to mess God's work up. He doesn't have the capacity to even do that. So his own simple, stupid strategy, as foolish as that is, it works for him. Is to plant something inside you that will make you self-destroy yourself. Is to implant an ideology that will make you frustrate, that will frustrate your positive thinking. And before you know it, by that seemingly simple act, you have by yourself ruined your own destiny. So it's a seed he plants. When men slept, understand, when men slept, enemy came and planted a seed and did what? And went his own way. He won't stay with it. He knows. He's too sure that this seed he planted, and seed can be plenty. Seed can come in form of words. Something you just see someone do, it can just drop it in your heart. One bad thing you see someone do, you can just drop it in your heart. Something someone said about marriage that doesn't work, can just drop it in your heart. That's a seed. It will just drop that seed in your heart. Show you a little bit of example, even if some of it may even reflect in your heart, in your own life. The moment you agree about it, that's it. You are in. You are locked in. Yeah, we saw that seed and go its own way. That seed generally, that seed in particular is meant to germinate and self-destroy you. So it is what you think. It is what you accept. It is what you agree with in life that becomes your end result. You can't just sit and say, "My, it doesn't work." So from early age, you need to learn how to hear God. You can't psych God into hearing Him when it's time to choose a marital partner. God will not listen. Bible is always saying, serve God in the days of your youth. When you are young, when you don't even think you need God, start needing God that time. Because God is not a foolish God. As merciful as you see Him, He's a very mean person. God can watch you perish and do nothing about it. See, my people perish for lack of knowledge. His own people, I mean His own very people, not pagans, not unbelievers. My own people perish for lack of knowledge. So it's very possible for a man to enter perdition by himself. And God will look at you and do nothing about it. Don't tell me God will save you. God will help us. We are always using all those religious words. God will help us. Who told you God will help you? You can be perishing and God will be looking at you and do nothing. Jesus saw that guy. Say, what can I do for you? An obvious blind man. So there are a lot of times God pretends He doesn't even see us. So that's how He is. Because after dropping a lot of kingdom keys for you, He expects us by now to have grown in the maturity of the knowledge of these things, that we can use them by ourselves. So these are the things about marriage. You can actually believe this thing works, and when it works, when you think it works, it's a mindset. It works for you. Start by hearing God very early in life. You pick it. These are the four. Immediately you got born again, one of the first things that should happen to you is you need to start hearing the voice. It's not the same. It's the same Holy Spirit that you got that day that opens your ears, pop up your ears, and you start hearing things. You start feeling things in your mind. You start hearing the voice in your mind. We don't hear in our ears. We hear in our minds. It's not to just come to you and you have peace. You have strong feelings about it. 2-3 years ago, my wife is a witness. I started feeling strong feelings about building. There were times I would almost have an accident on the road because I was looking at the building construction. My wife would see. We go like, what is it with you and this building thing? I say, I started having a very strong feeling towards block building. And I told her I can pick it by the Spirit that the next phase of my life will have to do with this thing, because the way my spirit is drawing towards it, I can tell that there's something God saying about it. So that is how we hear God. It's not you hearing one audible voice. And a lot of you that sit with dreams and thinking dreams are enough as GPRS to direct your destiny. I have a very bad news for you. You will be misled in life. You are not likely to reach your place of destiny. Why? Because devil, it's a spirit. Spiritual realms can be accessed majorly in the night. That's why they meet in the night. God is an omnipresent God, but there's something about night. When you sleep, when man slept, enemy came. You know, I've quoted that same scripture today. When enemy slept, devil came and sowed a seed. So what you see in your dreams, most likely 70% of what you see in your dreams are devil's work. It's not always God all the time. Don't assume everything you dream about is God. God doesn't need your dream to speak to you. You can be awake alive when your head is correct. That's when God speaks to you. You don't need to sleep before God talks to you. Is He coming to remove your ribs? God did something to Adam when he slept. You don't need you to sleep. What are you sleeping for? Understand? So when God wants to speak to you, most of the time you are awake. Your senses are sharp. Yeah. It's devil that sneak inside dream to be talking to people. So don't let your life be guarded by dreams. Don't guard your life by dreams at all. It's children, it's babes in the kingdom that guard their life by dreams. You are more than that. You need to learn to hear on time. When you give birth to a child, at 3 months old, they start knowing your voice. At 3 months, they start knowing your voice. They start speaking before one. Some of them start speaking before age one. Before they start working, they start speaking. They start hearing. How will you feel here having a 5-year-old child, a 10-year-old child, who can't even hear your own voice? Immediately, you take the child to the hospital. You start examining their eardrums and running tests and all of that. That's how we are in the kingdom. Imagine you, God having you. You got born again and you can't even hear. Seriously. That's a shame. That's a shame on salvation. That's a shame on what you claim you believe. That's a total shame on what we call soteria. Seriously. You need to learn to hear God. You cannot hear God until you have something called the secret place, until you have something called an altar. Consistency in these things is what builds trust. These things are every natural thing you see, they are proverbs of the Spirit. Anything you see around you, they are proverbs of the Spirit. Consistency is a thing, is a proof that you are really serious about it, and consistency will actually draw the attention of someone to convincing them that, okay, he's trying to prove a point. So when you are consistent in your secret place, God begins to give you an attention. He doesn't just speak to anybody because he came to pray for one day. He won't even answer you in that first one day. God will start responding to people after consistently showing up in the place of prayer, in the place of worship, in the place of surrender. Only dead men can hear God. Only dead men can hear God. You have to be dead to self. You have to be dead to life. That's when your spirit can be in tune, can be inclined to hearing the Most High. He dwells in the secret place, in the mighty place where no human can access. Where no humans can access. So, hearing from that kind of distance requires a spirit. It has to be by a frequency. It has to be by a Wi-Fi. You have to pick it. It's not inside the eardrum. It's inside the heart. Your word am I hidden in my heart that I might not sin against you. So these things are things of the mind. They are. You know, the bodies, we are tripartite beings, body, soul, and spirit. God connects with our spirit. God connects. The only link God has to humans is through the spirit. There's nothing. Your body, okay, he made it, but he can't relate with it. Till now, God made the body. If not Jesus that came in human flesh, before Jesus came, God had no idea how human flesh functioned till the time Jesus came. It was God that stepped out of God to experience what humans feel. That was the little inclination God had into wearing flesh. If not, he has no idea. So the only link of God to man is just via the Spirit. So you have to learn to hear God. You have to learn the things that will increase the frequency of your spirit and downgrade your flesh. You have to look for things that will do that will hype your spirit man and degrade your human flesh. Understand? Things like fasting. You have to overcome sleep, you have to overcome food, you have to overcome talking. Reduce talking to humans. If you want to hear God, you have to hear less of men so that you can hear more of God. That's how these things function. You cannot just call in, some people just be on the phone forever, call them, their alarm is always busy. I wonder, what the hell are you saying? Understand? You have to develop this God connection kind of thing. I marvel when people say they pray for 12 hours. I just look at them. My spirit is connected to this kingdom thing 18 hours a day. An average of 18. When I wake up, I must do something about the kingdom. All the day, I type and bless all of you. I come online, I do kingdom 18. I'm connected 24/7. My spirit must have to be sharp. All the things I type, I don't write them anywhere. I just download them. When I open that portal in my mind, when I have time out of my real estate work, I just sit down, bring my phone on. It will fall. Now I just said I'm coming online. What I will say, I have no idea. Some of you just wear big suits. You are always struggling for pulpit. Without you preparing, if I give you mic, come and preach for 1 hour, do you know what to say? Some of you don't know, you'll just be saying rubbish. All you cram will just scatter. After 10 minutes, you've forgotten all the apostle message you cram. Some of you will go and be listening to men of God so that you can use it to preach. You are doing yourself. You are not even grown, you want to grow others. Learn to hear. Let your ears be open. So learn to hear God. That's one way to enter a good marriage. That's how God speaks to you. God still directs people in marriage. Yes, after Adam blamed God, God was like, okay, because Adam, why did you do what you did? You know, because God had no business with Eve. He didn't give Eve instructions. Adam again, it's Eve that ate the apple. Yes, but God did not meet Eve. He met Adam. Guy, what happened here? It was like, the woman you gave me. So God was like, okay, now this how it is. It's me that gave you. Oh, it's now bad for me to look at you and see that you need help below your waist. You need someone to help you below your waist. Yeah, they're saying it's me. Ah, okay then. Let's change the rule a little bit. So God changed the rule. He now said, whoever finds a woman finds a good thing. It now became your own job to go and find. And one of the ways you can find is to still ask the same God who gave Adam. Aha, it's your job to find. So technically, if you never ask God, he will never do anything about it. Who is following me? Am I online? Am I communicating? Are you getting me? Are you listening? So if you never ask God, he's never going to tell you nothing. He'll be looking at you perishing like this, shaking his head, and that's it. So a guy called me yesterday and was asking me, he doesn't even know how to speak to a lady. And the first thing that crossed my mind is, how old are you? He said 18. I was so angry. I was like, okay, that's it. It's not time yet. Just forget about it. Guess what he told me? That he has finished university. And my jaw sank. My heart sank. How can you finish university at 18? You know, our educational system is beginning to tilt. It's beginning to tilt the age of maturity. The definition of maturity is beginning to change relative to how fast people graduate from school now. So how will you look at someone that has finished school and tell him not to have a relationship, for example? You know, that's what next? You serve, you get a job, 20, someone like that serves at 19, get a job at 20. You can decide to say you want to get married at 21. What do you want to stop him for? It's not like us. At 18, are we even in 100 level? So these are the disparity in dispensations that we ministers need to understand. How fast changing this generation is, the coming generations are. So we need to put that into consideration. There's no age limit to doing this thing. I've seen old fools before, and I've seen young wise people before. It's not about age. Age is just a calendar. Age is just it's just a number. Your real age is measured by spiritual intelligence. Your real age is measured by spiritual maturity. By mind renewal, rubbing your mind with the word of God. You know, those were the things that qualified Jesus to stand in the temple and teach elders, despite his age. He taught so till his parents went back to where they were, and he was lost in the temple. They forgot him in the temple. He was teaching and teaching. Because he was so wise, they were wondering, who is this guy? Who is this small boy just vibing wisdom like this? You know, Jesus grew in wisdom. You have to grow in wisdom. You have to grow in wisdom. This thing will affect everything you do. It will affect everything you do. So that's about relationship. You need to dress well. To look together. You need to dress well. Look together. Everybody wants people they will be proud about. Everybody likes who they will be proud about. It's not about God says. God says what? Quit lying, God said. What did God say? Out of all the matters in the world, out of all the matters of the cold world, the second coming of Jesus, the mansion they are building in heaven, God will leave all of that and come and be telling you about one sister. It's a lie. God did not say anything. Your mind says you like the person finished. Don't involve God in this thing. God said what? Come on, man. Me, I don't like when you spiritualize things. You like someone is you like someone. Don't see God says. This thing is first love. It's first. Yes, there's an spiritual intuition, a spiritual inclination to things. But don't wrap it up all in spirituality. there's something in you that triggered. There's something called love in you that triggered that made you love someone. Don't start saying it's God all the time. Leave God alone, I beg. He has too much thing to put on himself. We are 7.8 billion, they said. It's you that God will be talking about one babe to. Just say, yes, madam. Wow, I really like how you look. I went to check you on Facebook. I was just stumbling through Facebook. I stumbled on your pictures. I really like how you look. Show her the picture. I like this particular picture. How did you make your hair? This hair, just tell me about it. Is it Ghana weaving? Is it braids? Tell me. How long did it take you to make it? You know, things like that. Just pack up the conversation. Start from natural things. Don't always be ascending spiritual height all the time. Don't just be talking about spiritual things all the time. Be natural. You are a human being. Even Jesus, I was half human, half God. I mean, full man, full God. Sorry, nothing like half God. Full man, full God. He was doing natural things. Some of you just sound spiritual like you are deputy Holy Spirit. Come on, man. You like a baby, you like a baby. There's no two words about it. You know, learn to calm down. Calm down. Sisters don't really like when you hype things to the spiritual realm that nobody is even understanding what you are saying. So you calm down. Talk like man. Pray at home. Don't come and start prayer session when you are supposed to speak to a baby intelligently. A lot of you that just brag with all those big suits and long tie like sword, you can't even win a woman. If you can't win a lady, can I send you out to the field to go and evangelize? And I told the guy yesterday, if you cannot win a babe, I'm not sure you can win a soul for God. It's the same skill. It's the same tactics. If you cannot win a woman, you are letting javelin, natural woman. How can you communicate the spirit of a person and convert them to Jesus, a Muslim? You know, that's a tall order. That's a white elephant project. That's all I'm saying. So, these are things that trains you, train your mind. You know, there are times that natural things can actually train you for spiritual things. You just think it's a joke. As a very shy person, I can't talk to a woman, but after I gave my life to Christ in 2000, my God, a spirit just landed on me, changed the way I talk, changed the way I reason, the way my wisdom level just moved up, boom, because I would wake up and study Bible like I had jump exam. My sister would wake up and be like, light went, you on candle, you are reading Bible, you. I said, no. They decided joining me, but for how long? Consistency is the one that will define songs from those that are just expecting to see manifestations. Because there are two classes. There are some that are out there to manifest, and there are some jobless ones. Their job is just to await the manifestation of the songs. So you need to define where you're going to be. So learn to talk. Don't say that's my nature. There is no human being that arrives this earth with a nature. It's you that chose it. Everything you are, you were trained by somebody. Nobody was. We were all born into this planet with a plain heart. Nobody came here with an attitude. Everything we picked from someone. Somebody trained you. So don't accept you are a product of somebody's coaching. I'm melancholy. I'm sanguine. I'm sanding. All those things are stupid. They are crap. I never read that book, and I will never read it because it makes no sense to me. You can't stand and define who I am for me. Jesus was a necessary guy. He was a lion when he should be a lion. He was a lamb when he should be a lamb. And that's who I am. I am very, very unpredictable. You can see another total side of me. I am like the wind. You can't hold me. You can't catch me. You can't predict this is what I'm going to do. What you do determines what I do. That's how Jesus works. How Jesus picked pick cane and flog the nonsense out of people in the temple. Just imagine, you know me, I try to reincarnate Bible stories. Just try to imagine a Jesus that is flogging people in the temple for whatever reason. Whatever reason. Just try to imagine it. That is a betrayal of the Jesus we know as a meek person that set a prostitute free. You understand? That's the total departure from the Jesus we knew. So you don't have temperament, as it were. Don't say you can't talk to a babe. What you do, what you see, who you are is a product of someone's coaching. So don't define your life by who trained you. You can always retrain your mind and be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. Not renewal, renewing. Transformation can only be guaranteed by the consistent renewal. And consistent renewal is the English word for renewing, present continuous. It's present, you do it in present and you continue it. That's called renewal. You don't do it once and not do it again. What works is birth in the place of consistency. You know, those are the things that work. You need to embrace marriage. Let it be important to you. Make up your mind from start that you're going to have a good home. The parents that gave birth to you, they are just transport system that brought you to this world. Honor them, give them their honor, or you can be a total departure from who your parent was. I'm sure if my dad saw me now, he will have to be sure that he will have to check and be like, are you sure I gave birth to this boy? As far back as 10 years ago, he has already been saying that I look nothing like him. I just wish, I don't even know what he would say now if you saw me, you know, I don't even know what he would say now. So, you can be a total difference from who gave birth to you. So, how the home you will grow up in is not a template. So, if you have started following what your father did, God saved you, my father, I know what he will do. You will have exactly the same result. Exactly what the result he had is what you have. So there's no point. It's your job to sit down and draft a new future for yourself. You have to recalibrate your own mind, you know, to in conformity with the principles of the kingdom, with the word of God, and all these things. Those are what is able to recharge your destiny and make you begin a totally different generation from what you were, the genealogy you were born in. It aligns you to the genealogy of giants. You know, everybody is born, we were born again, and after being born again, there's another born in that is totally different from the natural birth, which is to be born again. It is the queue which giants are queued up, such that we all look alike in this particular kingdom, in this particular phase called the kingdom of God. That's why I can be here, be saying something to you, and Pastor Selma is saying the same thing in Zaria, and you put on TV, you are hearing the same thing. It's a school of the spirit. It's a spiritual realm called the kingdom of God. We attend the same class, the same school. Sad things. So you need to make up your mind for marriage and be sure you're ready for it. It's not about money. Wherever love is, I always say it, money will come. So embrace it, love it, and know that money will never come until you are a seed sower. Now I'm linking everything together because I'm rounding off in a bit. Money is not going to come until you are a seed sower. Abraham's blessings are mine. Shut up. Abraham's blessing is not permitted to be yours until you've done the stuff Abraham did. Abraham went to fight a battle. He won the battle, and when you won those days, everything in that city, you packed it and you went to your home. And you packed it and it became yours. All the people become your servants. So when Abraham won and was living where he went to fight and won, he met the king of Salem. He met Melchizedek, the king of Salem. And he was that was the very spot where tithing started. He gave him a tenth of every spoil he got in that city. He gave him a tenth of it. King of Salem is a picture of Jesus that has double title. He was a king of Salem. He was a king on that. He was an authority on that. And he was a Melchizedek king. He was a Melchizedek, a representation of God. Representation of God. You understand? That's a spiritual. He has a spiritual office and a political office. Very good. Now I have the right word for it. A spiritual office and a political office. And that's how Jesus was. The government shall be upon his shoulder. That is his own synergy with the King of Salem. And is the savior of the world. And that's his Melchizedek connection. We do not have an high priest that is not touched with the feelings of our infirmity. Jesus came in the order of Melchizedek. Everybody that arrived in this world, he came in orders. Jesus came in the order of Melchizedek. So is some of us that came. It's only Melchizedek that I endorsed from heaven to collect tithes. And look at Solomon, like, they started, all these young pastors, you are your own. They are Melchizedek on earth. You can know them by people you sow to, and in less than 7 days, you started seeing results in your life. It's like jazz. It's like almost instant. The first time I listened to Apostle Simon, that thing told me that this man is a Melchizedek on earth. And I went to drop things at his feet, and almost on the spot, my life started changing. Same as my pastor. Those are Melchizedek on earth. You have to locate them. There are not plenty. It's not everybody that open church that is just going to be dropping money there and be saying, you are paying offering, you are paying this, you are paying that. I'm not discouraging you. But know that they are givings and they are givings. They are Melchizedek, they are endorsed. You know them by the result you get in your life after giving them things. I'm not trying to promote anybody or anything. I'm just talking kingdom. I'm talking Bible. Thank God I'm a businessman. Nobody can accuse me. I'm so loving my life because I wanted to blow. I wanted to talk in the fullness of these things, but I told God that I need my own personal money. Bless me personally, so that when I talk like this, nobody will be looking at me funny like, it's people sowing that is using to buy a car. It's not your business. I do business. If I gather everything everybody has sown on social media, I'm not sure you can buy eight of my tires that I drive. My Infinity tire alone, one of his 17 rims. If I tell you how much money is, understand. I'm not trying to brag, but I'm just letting you know. So that you know that some of these things you do it for your own sake. The land I even gave Apostle, till now, I'm not even sure he knows where the thing is. It's even possible the document is even lost, sir. So I did this for my own self, not because of him. He may not even need it. There are people that will give him things in Meitama, that will give him properties in Asokoro. My own will even be almost be nothing. I'm doing this for my own self. That's the mentality you need to have when you are sowing. Don't sow and never sow again. I'll be waiting for the result of the one you sow. Before you sow another one, you won't get a result like that. I've talked about consistency. This thing is consistency. Consistency is the only spiritual principle that brings results. If you are not consistent in what you do, everyone will just sit and be laughing at you. Angels will just sit and be laughing at you. Before God will even take your worship, you must have been consistent there. God takes the worship of angels because they've been doing it like forever. Holy, holy, holy. God will not look at your face and nod his head when the first time he said holy. He will stay and look at you falling from afar, shaking his leg that, okay, is this one really serious? Let's keep watching him. God will keep watching you. He will keep watching you until he can ascertain that this one is qualified to be listened to. So those are the things. If you are not a sower, you are not permitted to be a harvester. You did not plant yam. People are going for harvest and you are carrying baskets. Where are you going? Are you going to steal? Blessing is not a congregational thing. Get it? It's a personal thing that is a derivative of what you dropped. It's a derivative of what you dropped at the feet of Jesus. It's not a congregational favor that land on in a church. No, everybody is given what they are able to give back and traded with and brought back to God. Is the bringing back that results in the increase. It's not just, Pastor, pray for me. Ah, I need your prayer. I seek your prayers. See, you're always seeking prayers. When the result comes, what do you do with it? You disappear. And you are coming, definitely. The person that prayed for you, by spiritual intelligence, know that you are coming back for more because you will still be in need. You will still be in need. When I met Apostle Joshua Aguila, I just went to, I did a use of word conference. All I got was about 70K. I did honorarium with 20K, remained 50K. I turned it to mint. Jesus said, I should go and give this man. And I converted it to mint. I went to drop everything at the apostles' feet. What are you saying? Even if he didn't pray for me, that act alone will make me not to be coming back every Sunday and pray for me. When you are coming back too much, okay, you're a greedy person. You don't sow. That's why I keep coming back. You are always in need. Hey, pray for me. Pray for me. The person praying for you say we're tired. There is something, there is one time seed you drop and Abba, even if you don't come for 1 year, the result will be speaking on your head. Those are the things. So you can sit and mock all these teachers and say, give me to collect money. See, when you have that mindset already, you have robbed yourself. Don't even bother at all. You have that mindset already have calibrated you into a category of people that will never go far in life. There's no point. When you have that mindset already, I have a bad news for you. You will, I know what can be in your obituary. You are not dying now. Well, after in your will, I know what will be there. People that think like that, I know what is in their will. What will be in their will. That's if they have anything at all. So, never join them to be saying, it's just gimmicks to collect money. See, men of God, you are looking at. It's not your offering there. From the little things I'm doing now, I understand a lot of how these big pastors operate. It's not your offering they are using to build, to live large and do what they are doing. It's not your offering, no? It's not your offering. Do you know how much offering? Okay, if we ask everybody, open your offering in church, open it, let's all see it. You'll be seeing 15 naira. You see 100 naira, you see 200 naira, the maximum you see maybe 500, 1,000, couple of 1,000. And some of those 1,000, ushers will have removed it. I pity you. If you are an usher, you are doing that. You are placing a curse on you, your destiny and your children. They put you in a church, you are removing the biggest denomination. Pastor will test some of you and send somebody to drop 100 pounds. Three of them. Inside, I'm seeing some of you. That's why my spirit is diverting me like this. Drop foreign currency in the offering. It will never show up in the counting room. They will never see it. And the pastor will keep quiet. You are playing with doom. If you are that, you need to send me a message. And I need to God is sending me to release you this time. If not, there's nothing you will do that will prosper. You may think it's a small church that God has not started answering. You are carrying all the problem of the church. You'll be shocked. Your children will partake out of it. It's not a curse. So these are spiritual things. God does not joke with money. Anything money, God doesn't play with it. Thank God. Can any man serve God and mammon together? Mammon, which is the spirit of money, is the only thing compared with God. God is so big that he didn't even compare himself with devil. Devil, okay. He's too far. But money, you know, you need to learn these things. Learn these things. It's a law of exchange. Anything you have not dropped, you are not permitted to pick it. You're a thief. You didn't drop, you want to pick. I should sue you, for example. Like this worldly song. Don't be you a carry come, Abi. How did they sing? But if you are a carry go. You don't carry come, you won't carry go. Are you stupid? Understand? So that's the law of harvest. It's the law of harvest. What you sow is what you reap. Simple. It's simple. But it's not, when you sow prayer, you get more prayer points. When you sow money, you get money. You don't pray for money. You don't pray for financial this thing. And if you ask anything in my name, I will give it for you. Is it that simple? Is that all that there is to do? You better don't be reading Bible. You just pick contextual. You just pick a scripture out of the Bible and be running with it. You need to read the Bible as a whole. Know everything that is connected to it before you just pick one and run with it. Prayer is the key. I've never seen that word in the Bible. That particular word, prayer is the key. The key. I've never seen it in the Bible. There's some things you can't pray for. You know me, I'll keep saying it. I don't care who is telling you it's possible. You might have gotten to the level where even if they whistle at the devil, bring money. If whistle at their angels, bring money, they will bring. Inside prayer. You are not in the same level with them. You are not in the same level. At your level now, you can't pray for money. You have to work principles. They worked principles to an extent that there is nothing, every direction they turn to, feel door open. You cannot compare your grace with them. You can't. So, make sure that this thing is part of your arsenal on your way to success. No man has risen to level of success in the kingdom without understanding some of these principles. By privilege and by honor, I have been connected to some of these young giants that have risen financial, become financial pillars in this age. I've sat with them and I found out that these guys do the same things. They do the same things. One told me how they carry dangerous seed to go and be Bishop Oyedepo, and I'm wondering, what am I doing? Like, seriously. You, come on. You know, these are guys that were born with the same womb like you. These are guys that, they don't have two heads. It's just a decision. When we talk like this, God will say, some of you time, oh, God, give me grace. Which dumb grace? There's no grace like that. There's no grace. You just decide one day. Which day are you just going to say, okay? Okay, what is that precious thing you have? Okay, I have a gold. I have a gold chain. I bought the 70,000. You just remove it inside the church. Drop it inside offering bowl and go. Or you just say, okay, I'm going to sell this gold chain and give it to God. Just look for something that you know you love most. Punish yourself and drop it for God. Those are ways to... God told Abraham, give me your son. If you are stuck in, I want your son. Give me your son. You would have gone to wholeheartedly carry Ishmael. Because Ishmael was just an unexpected boy, so to speak. So Abraham, it was not Abraham's favorite. The sweet smelling savour sacrifice to God is the one that you serve love most. So it's a connection of divinity and humanity. What you love most is what God loves most. So there's always a contention between what you love most and what God loves most. Your ability to submit what you love most for what God loves most makes you a spiritually intelligent person. Someone ready to have a life of results. Understand? When you stand and you are struggling with your maker, what you love is what God loves. And you won that contest. You're a stupid person before God. I'm sorry to say. If what you love, God is demanding for it, and you won the battle, you never gave it. By not giving it means you won. It means God, you know what? No, this one, just ask of another thing. But as far as this one, don't bother about it. I want it. I can't leave it. No, this particular one, I saved it to use it for something. And no, if I touched it, I won't be able to do it. Those things are not true. God will owe no man. The best way to handcuff God, it's to turn him to someone owing you. That's what I do to God. You don't know some of my secrets. I turn God to a debtor. And I know that let heavens and earth come down. God will never owe any man. He can break everything except owing anybody. So I will make him owe me. That's how I do. I will force him to owe me by all means. When I told you the story of how I signed any million, I told God, God, I want to enter this realm of millions. He told me, oh, you pay the tithe of it to my servant. immediately I looked for the 100,000. I just forwarded it. I did not plan for it. It didn't cross my heart. I was just teaching in upper room group, and I was teaching about this thing, and God said I should start it with my own self, and I did it immediately. I think about 14 days later, I sold a land for 700 and some, no, for 970 something thousand. I see the deal of 970 something thousand, and I found that I have 30,000 in my GTB. I just merged everything together. For the first time in my life, I saw a million that is my own. I'm not selling for anybody waiting for commission. Go and give them the book. I'll not take the peanuts. No. That was the first time. So these things are, imagine I never did what I did. I would just lock up on the main mountain and be praying like some of you. See, I'm not discouraging some of the spiritual exercises you do. But some of these things are just bribery for power. God does not give power. He will not give power to people who are bribing him. He can tell hearts. What do you want to even do with the power? Number one, that's where God starts with. See, people that walk in power, they are people that never planned it. We didn't plan this thing. We don't use to realize that, ha, God, give me power. I know it. Power. Calm down. Okay, don't kill yourself before your time. God does not give power like that. People that find themselves in dangerous spiritual realms that operate miracles are people who never plan for it. They were just loving God. They were just worshiping. They were just consistent. They were just doing what they got to do. They just found themselves inside there. God is not a dumb God. You too, if you have children doing things, different things that I'm preaching now, which one will you love most? The one that you just came from office, is the one that removed your suit, is the one that will go and hang them, is the one that kneels down and wash them, is the one that will play with your head and be singing worship for you and be singing your praises, and the one that will just be asking you for things. Daddy, I want school fees. Daddy, I want school fees. Daddy, I want shoes. Ah, daddy, my school uniform has torn. Which one will you like most? Let us be playing the role of God on earth. Let's try and imagine things. Our imaginations are sharp. That's how I learn things. You imagine God. Are you just killing yourself on the mountain? Your heart is not even correct. You hate people. You are bitter with people making progress. And you are the one sleeping on mountain. What exactly are you doing on mountain? This snake will bite you. You will know that you have trespassed territory. There's nothing you are saying on the mountain that you cannot say inside the room. I locked myself in the room and God opened doors for me. I actually wanted to disappear and go to Ghana and lock myself in a room for 31 days. I planned it, but transport fare never came. And thank God I never went, because I asked my wife one day, I sat her down, that, babe, come. If I had gone to Ghana, that I said I wanted to go and lock up and become a new man. If I had gone to Ghana and came back the way I am now, will you have ever believed I did not go and do just blood money? She just smiled. Till today, she has not answered me. Till today, she has not answered. So, I thank God I did not go. What am I trying to say? Anywhere you are, God can answer you. It's about your heart connection, not about mountain. Going high on the mountain is not proximity to God. You are thinking like people who wanted to build Tower of Babel. You think it's by how high you go up there that makes you hear God or connected. I can descend low into the well and tell you to go on the mountain and go and pray and let us see who is connected. Then I preach passion. I preach reality. I'm not discouraging your spiritual exercises, but you need to understand why you do what you do. No, don't do things because people are doing them. So these things are spiritual laws. These are spiritual laws. How did I get here? I'm talking about seed sowing. And just basic things that lift me. Anything you cannot walk away from, just forget it. Anything you can't walk away from, just forget it. That mind telling you that when you drop it, you will never be able to do what you want to do. It's just fluke. It's fluke. My dad gave me 750K. Inside this is my ticket. Be removing it. Inside this is my ticket. Inside is my school fees. Inside is my pocket money and everything I have to do. By the time you convert 750K into pounds alone, it's change you will have. But that one did not bother me. I took $118,000. I went to drop the $1,000 seed that I promised God. I dropped it, and the rest changed in my heart. I still did passport, did all this thing, you know, gave people money, and said to what I went to UK with was just almost nothing. I had to look for the cheapest flight to, I remember I booked Bellevue Airline when everybody ran for it, that it was killing, the airline was dropping. I booked it and spoke in tongues, this one will get to London. It's cheap, yes. I will enter it like that. I booked Bellevue Airline, I think I paid 99K and all of that. So, I went to UK. There was threat for me not to finish that degree. There is nothing devil did not do for me to not to finish that degree. But I finished. Because my start was correct, sir. My start was very correct. Eh? How can I save $1,000 and go to UK and never had a degree? It's not possible. It's not possible. I finished that degree. I have a master's degree from United Kingdom inside my house now. As I land there, a distant cousin of mine, the father called her. That I am in UK, you should locate me and take me as a brother. I can count how many times I cooked in the whole of UK for 5 years. Somebody was just cooking and responsible for my feed. I'm talking about a big sister now. Before your mind will start thinking of another thing. I have two big sisters that would never even, they laugh when they hear that I cook. And I can cook well. They will just be laughing like, oh, Shegun, why do you bother yourself? I told you not to be disturbed. You just stay and be cooking. That's very funny. Anything you want, just let us know. When I'm broke, I just go to their house, open their fridge. I will do shopping in their house, bring everything home. When they go and shop, they shop for me. You know, that was how I lived a very good life in UK. I lived a very good life. That thing telling you when you drop it, you'll never be able to do what you want to do is a lie. Okay, my pocket money, I dropped it and God sent angels to take care of me. How about that? You know, so these things are just understanding and trust. Anything, when you can't drop it, you don't trust God. That's the meaning. So that's about seed sowing. And all of that, honor. Well, I can't talk too much about honor. It's just, I don't think I'll be able to touch that today. Time has gone. You know, I need to round off now. I hope you just gained something. I didn't plan nothing. I didn't write nothing. I don't preach with jotters and preaching notes. By the Spirit, I just connect. And wherever I hear, that's why I teach. That's why I preach. And that's what I'm just doing right now. I'm sorry. May not be your pattern, but I want that to be my pattern. I want to be like, I want to fashion my talks like Joy Austin and all of that. Just flow. Jesus does not have a preaching note from communication. You will just enter a topic. When you did this one well, you answered this question, right? From there, he begins to bring out topics and divert into topics. Understand? Who do men say I am? Everybody missed it. One guy got it. You are the son of the living God. From there, he said, wow, you guys got it. Then he changed his topic. He started talking about kingdom keys. I'll give unto you kingdom keys. Blah, 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 blah. You know, from there, from what you say, he bring out topic. And just flow. That's how to do these things. Not when you sit down and listen to Apostle's message. You want to cram everything he's saying and be using all the words he used, dimension, track record, teach that, da, da, da. You can't be a good preacher like that. Okay? I don't know who you are. I'm sent to you. You just listen to Apostle's message to go and download in your fellowship. You think that's impact? That's why it's not affecting anybody. It has to come from your own spirit. He sat down to develop himself. That's why he's saying all those things effortlessly. I'm sorry, I'm not proud, but I've not listened to Apostle in the last 7 months. Listen to one message and finish it. No, I'm not. Because I don't want to vomit anybody verbatim. I don't want to be a direct photocopy of any man of God on earth. I want to mix their own with my own originality. And my own originality is much more important to me than copying exactly what some people say. So that's my life, and that's what I want to do. So let all these things matter to you. Let it matter to you. I spoke about marriage, relationship, and I spoke about seed sowing. So we bless God for tonight. I'm so grateful. As some of you are able to connect, Thanks for joining us. God bless you in Jesus' mighty name.